This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Former parties Cambodia KPK KPRP Indonesia Korea Malaya and Singapore Marxist-Leninist Revolutionary Faction Philippines Saudi Arabia Sarawak Taiwan Thailand Europe Albania Armenia Austria. Po Ki Azerbaijan Belarus KPB Belgium PVDA, PTB KPPC Bosnia and Herzegovina Bulgaria Cyprus Czech Republic Denmark DKP KPID Estonia Finland France. PCF PCOF Georgia Germany Greece K COA ACOA Hungary Ireland CPI WPI Italy PRC PDCI PMLI Luxembourg Malta Moldova Netherlands Norway Poland Portugal Romania Russia CPR FRC WP CPSU San Marino Slovakia Spain PCE PCC PCPE Sweden KPSKP Switzerland Turkey DHKP, CHTKP KDH, LKKP TKP MKP MLKP TDKP TKEP TKEP, LTKEP TKP, ML Ukraine United Kingdom CPRCG. CPGB MLN CPB CPS Former parties Albania Czechoslovakia East Germany Italy Netherlands Poland Romania Soviet Union Turkey United Kingdom West Germany Yugoslavia Oceania Australia. Communist Alliance CPA CPAML Resistance Socialist Alliance New Zealand CLCPAOMU SPA Former Parties Australia DSPRSP Victorian Socialist Party New Zealand CPNZ SUP WCL Related Topics Communism History Marxism Leninism Democratic Centralism VE The Communist Party USA CPUSA is a communist political party in the United States. It is the largest communist party in the country established in 1919. It has a long, complex history that is closely tied with the U.S. labor movement and the histories of communist parties worldwide. Contents 1 Overview 2 History 21 Formation and Early History 1919-1921 The Red Scare and the Communist Party 1919-1923-23 The Factional War 1923-1929-24 The Third Period 1928-1935 25 The Popular Front 1935-1939-26 Opposition to Foreign Involvement 1939-1941-27 World War II and After 1941-1947-28 Second Red Scare 1947-1958-29 Party in Crisis 1956-1989-210 From Glasnost to the 21st Century 1989 Present 3 Ideology 31 The CPUSA Constitution Program 32 Bill of Rights Socialism 33 Living Standards 34 Imperialism and War 35 Women and Minorities 36 The Environment 37 Religion 4 Relations with Other Groups 41 The U.S. Labor Movement 42 Soviet Funding and Espionage 43 Criminal Prosecutions 44 African Americans 45 The Gay Rights Movement 46 The U.S. Peace Movement 5 Presidential Ticket 6 Top Party Leaders 7 See also 8 Footnotes 9 Further Reading 10 Archives 11 External Links Overview for the first half of the 20th century, the Communist Party was a highly influential force in various struggles for democratic rights. It played a prominent role in the U.S. labor movement from the 1920s through the 1940s, having a major hand in founding most of the country's first industrial unions which would later use the McCarran Internal Security Act to expel their communist members while also becoming known for opposing racism and fighting for integration in workplaces and communities during the height of the Jim Crow period of U.S. racial segregation. Historian Ellen Schrecker concludes that decades of recent scholarship offer a more nuanced portrayal of the party as both a Stalinist sect tied to a vicious regime and the most dynamic organization within the American left during the 1930s and 40s. By August 1919, only months after its founding, the Communist Party claimed 50,000 to 60,000 members. Members also included anarchists and other radical leftists at the time. The older and more moderate Socialist Party of America, suffering from criminal prosecutions for its anti-war stance during World War I, had declined to 40,000 members. The sections sections of the Communist Party's International Workers' Order organized for communism around linguistic and ethnic lines, providing mutual aid and tailored cultural activities to an IWO membership that peaked at 200,000 at its height. But the Communist Party's early labor and organizing successes did not last as the decades progressed. The combined effects of the Second Red Scare, McCarthyism, Nikita Khrushchev's 1956 secret speech denouncing the previous decades of Joseph Stalin's rule, and the adversities of the continued Cold War mentality, steadily weakened the party's internal structure and confidence. The party's membership in the Comintern and its close adherence to the political positions of the Soviet Union made the party appear to most Americans as not only a threatening, subversive domestic entity, but also as a foreign agent fundamentally alien to the American way of life. Internal and external crises swirled together, to the point where members who did not end up in prison for party activities tended either to disappear quietly from its ranks or to adopt more moderate political positions at odds with the Communists' party line. By 1957, membership had dwindled to less than 10,000, of whom some 1,500 were informants for the FBI. The party attempted to recover with its opposition to the Vietnam War during the civil rights movement in the 1960s, but its continued uncritical support for an increasingly stultified and militaristic Soviet Union increasingly alienated them from the rest of left-wing America, which saw this supportive role as outdated and even dangerous. At the same time, the party's aging membership demographics and noticeably hollow calls for peaceful coexistence failed to speak to a new left in the United States. With the rise of Mikhail Gorbachev and his effort to radically alter the Soviet economic and political system from the mid-1980s, the Communist Party finally became estranged from the leadership of the Soviet Union itself in 1989. The Communist Party of the Soviet Union cut off major funding to the CPUSA due to its opposition to glasnost and perestroika. With the dissolution of the Soviet Union in 1991, the party held its convention and attempted to resolve the issue of whether the party should reject Marxism-Leninism. The majority reasserted the party's now purely Marxist outlook, prompting a minority faction which urged social democrats to exit the now reduced party. The party has since adopted Marxism-Leninism within its program in 2014. The new draft of the party constitution declared, "We apply the scientific outlook developed by Marx, Engels, Lenin and others in the context of our American history, culture and traditions." The Communist Party USA is based in New York City for decades. Its West Coast newspaper was The People's World, and its East Coast newspaper was The Daily World. The two newspapers merged in 1986 into The People's Weekly World. The PWW has since become an online-only publication, called People's World. The party's former theoretical journal, Political Affairs Magazine, is now also published exclusively online, but the party still maintains international publishers as its publishing house. In June 2014, the party held its 30th National Convention in Chicago. History Formation and Early History. 1919-1921. Executive Secretary of the Communist Labor Party, Alfred Wagenknecht. See also, Communist Labor Party of America. The first U.S. socialist political party was the Socialist Labor Party, which was formed in 1876 and was for many years a viable force in the international socialist movement by the mid-1890s. However, the SLP came under the influence of Daniel de Leon, and his communist views led to widespread discontent amongst the members, leading to the formation of the reformist-oriented Socialist Party of America around the turn of the 20th century. A communist-oriented left wing gradually emerged within the SP, much to the consternation of many party leaders in January 1919. After the successful October Revolution in Russia 14 months earlier, Vladimir Lenin invited the Socialist Party of America to join the Communist International Comintern during the spring of 1919. The left wing caucus of the Socialist Party, buoyed by a large influx of new members from countries affected by the Russian Revolution, prepared to wrest control from the smaller controlling faction of moderate socialists. A referendum to join Comintern passed with 90% support, but the incumbent leadership suppressed the results. Elections for the party's National Executive Committee resulted in 12 leftists being elected out of a total of 15. Calls were made to expel moderates from the party. The moderate incumbents struck back by expelling several state organizations, half a dozen language federations, and many locals. In all, two-thirds of the membership. The Socialist Party then called an emergency convention on August 30, 1919, 2015, the party's left-wing caucus made plans at a June conference of its own to regain control of the party, by sending delegations from the sections of the party that had been expelled to the convention to demand that they be seated. However, the language federations, eventually joined by C. E. Ruthenberg and Louis C. Freyna, turned away from that effort and formed their own party, the Communist Party of America, at a separate convention on September 1, 1919. Meanwhile, plans led by John Reed and Benjamin Gitlow to crash the Socialist Party convention went ahead. Tipped off, the incumbents called the police, who obligingly expelled the leftists from the hall. The remaining leftist delegates walked out and, meeting with the expelled delegates, formed the Communist Labour Party on August 30, 1919. The Comintern was not happy with two communist parties in January 1920. An order was dispatched instructing the two, together consisting of about 12,000 members, to merge under the name United Communist Party of America, and to follow the party line established in Moscow. Charles Ruthenberg, J. Lovestone, and some other Communist Party of America members left their party in April and merged with the Communist Labour Party in May, becoming the United Communist Party due to a more strongly worded directive from the Comintern. The United Communist Party and the Communist Party of America under the leadership of Nicholas I Horich and Alexander Biddleman merged in May 1921, selecting the name of the latter. Many of the members came from the ranks of the industrial workers of the world, and only 5% were native English speakers. The Red Scare and the Communist Party 1919-1923. From its inception, the Communist Party USA came under attack from state and federal governments and later the Federal Bureau of Investigation in 1919, after a series of unattributed bombings, and attempted assassinations of government officials and judges later. Traced to militant adherents of the radical anarchist Luigi Galliani, the U.S. Department of Justice headed by Attorney General A. Mitchell Palmer, acting under the Sedition Act of 1918, began arresting thousands of foreign-born party members, many of whom the government deported. The Communist Party was forced underground and took to the use of pseudonyms and secret meetings in an effort to evade the authorities. The party apparatus was to a great extent underground. It re-emerged in the last days of 1921 as a legal political party called the Workers' Party of America. As the Red Scare and deportations of the early 1920s ebbed, the party became bolder and more open. An element of the party, however, remained permanently underground and came to be known as the CPUSA secret apparatus. During this time, immigrants from Eastern Europe are said to have played a very prominent role in the CPUSA. A majority of the members of the Socialist Party were immigrants, and an overwhelming percentage of the CPUSA consisted of recent immigrants. The factional war 1923-1929. Executive Secretary C. E. Ruthenberg, 1924. Now that the above-ground element was legal, the Communists decided that their central task was to develop roots within the working class. This move away from hopes of revolution in the near future to a more nuanced approach was accelerated by the decisions of the Fifth World Congress of the Comintern held in 1925. The Fifth World Congress decided that the period between 1917 and 1924 had been one of revolutionary upsurge, but that the new period was marked by the stabilization of capitalism and that revolutionary attempts in the near future were to be stopped. The American Communists embarked then on the arduous work of locating and winning allies. That work was, however, complicated by factional struggles within the CPUSA. The party quickly developed a number of more or less fixed factional groupings within its leadership, a faction around the party's executive secretary C. E. Ruthenberg, which was largely organized by his supporter J. Lovestone, and the Foster Cannon faction, headed by William Z. Foster, who headed the party's Trade Union Educational League, and James P. Cannon, who led the International Labor Defense ILD organization. Foster, who had been deeply involved in the steel strike of 1919 and had been a longtime syndicalist and a wobbly, had strong bonds with the progressive leaders of the Chicago Federation of Labor and, through them, with the Progressive Party United States, 1924 and nascent farmer labor parties under pressure from the Comintern. However, the party broke off relations with both groups in 1924. In 1925, the Comintern, through its representative Sergei Gusev, ordered the majority Foster faction to surrender control to Ruthenberg's faction. Foster complied. The factional infighting within the CPUSA did not end, however, the Communist Leadership of the New York locals of the International Ladies Garment Workers Union lost the 1926 strike of cloakmakers in New York City in large part because of intra-party factional rivalries. Ruthenberg died in 1927 and his ally, Lovestone, succeeded him as party secretary. Cannon attended the 6th Congress of the Comintern in 1928, hoping to use his connections with leading circles within it to regain the advantage against the Lovestone faction. However, Cannon and Maurice Spector of the Communist Party of Canada were accidentally given a copy of Trotsky's Critique of the Draft Program of the Comintern, that they were instructed to read and return. Persuaded by its contents, they came to an agreement to return to America and campaign for the document's positions. A copy of the document was then smuggled out of the country in a child's toy. Back in America, Cannon and his close associates in the ILD, such as Max Schachtman and Martin Abern, dubbed the Three Generals Without an Army, began to organize support for Trotsky's theses. However, as this attempt to develop a left opposition came to light, they and their supporters were expelled. Cannon and his followers organized the Communist League of America as a section of Trotsky's international left opposition at the same Congress. Lovestone had impressed the leadership of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union as a strong supporter of Nikolai Bukharin, the general secretary of the Comintern. This was to have unfortunate consequences for Lovestone when, in 1929, Bukharin was on the losing end of a struggle with Stalin and was purged from his position on the Politburo and removed as head of the Comintern in a reversal of the events of 1925. A Comintern delegation sent to the United States demanded that Lovestone resign as party secretary, in favor of his archrival Foster, despite the fact that Lovestone enjoyed the support of the vast majority of the American party's membership. Lovestone traveled to the Soviet Union and appealed directly to the Comintern. Stalin informed Lovestone that he had a majority because the American Communist Party until now regarded you as the determined supporter of the Communist International, and it was only because the party regarded you as friends of the Comintern that you had a majority in the ranks of the American Communist Party. When Lovestone returned to the United States, he and his ally Benjamin Gitlow were purged despite holding the leadership of the party ostensibly. This was not due to Lovestone's insubordination in challenging a decision by Stalin, but for his support for American exceptionalism, the thesis that socialism could be achieved peacefully in the United States. Lovestone and Gitlow formed their own group called the Communist Party Opposition, a section of the pro-Bukharin International Communist Opposition, which was initially larger than the Trotskyists but failed to survive past 1941. Lovestone had initially called his faction the Communist Party Majority Group in the expectation that the majority of the CPUSA's members would join him, but only a few hundred people joined his new organization. Although the Communist Party electorally remained a relatively insignificant party, especially compared to the more successful Socialist Party of America, it did manage to gain a foothold in some local areas. For instance, in Sheridan County in rural Montana, it managed to control a number of county offices and even elect one of its members to the state Senate in the late 1920s and early 1930s. Although under the Farmer Labor Party banner at the 1932 presidential election, Sheridan County gave 18% of its votes to Communist candidate William Z. Foster. However, the ideological changes of the third period alienated many of the farmers that supported the communists. By 1937, the party was all but gone from Sheridan County. The third period 1928 to 1935. The upheavals within the CPUSA in 1928 were an echo of a much more significant change: Stalin's decision to break off any form of collaboration with Western socialist parties, which were now condemned as social fascists. This policy had particularly severe consequences in Germany, where the German Communist Party not only refused to work in alliance with the German Social Democratic Party, but attacked it and its members. The impact of this policy in the United States was counted in membership figures. In 1928, there were about 24,000 members. By 1932, the total had fallen to 6,000 members. Opposing Stalin's third period policies in the Communist Party USA was James P. Cannon. For this action, he was expelled from the party. He then founded the Communist League of America with Max Schachtman and Martin Abern, and started publishing The Militant. It declared itself to be an external faction of the Communist Party until, as the Trotskyists saw it, Stalin's policies in Germany helped Hitler take power. At that point, they started working towards the founding of a new international, the Fourth International in the United States. The principal impact of the third period was to end the CPUSA's efforts to organize within the AFL through the Trade Union Educational League and to turn its efforts into organizing dual unions through the Trade Union Community League Foster went along with this change, even though it contradicted the policies he had fought for previously. By 1930, the party adopted the title of Communist Party of the USA, with the slogan of the United Front from Below. The party devoted much of its energy in the Great Depression to organizing the unemployed, attempting to found red unions, championing the rights of African Americans and fighting evictions of farmers and the working poor. It abandoned its previous plans to ship all African Americans back to the South and establish them in a Soviet Negro Republic. With the departure of Lovestone at the same time, the party attempted to weave its sectarian revolutionary politics into its day-to-day defense of workers, usually with only limited success. They recruited more disaffected members of the Socialist Party and an organization of African American socialists called the African Blood Brotherhood, some of whose members, particularly Harry Haywood, would later play important roles in communist work among blacks. In 1932, the retiring head of the CPUSA, William Z. Foster, published a book entitled Toward Soviet America, which laid out the Communist Party's plans for revolution and the building of a new socialist society based on the model of Soviet Russia. In that same year, Earl Browder became general secretary of the party. At first, Browder moved the party closer to Soviet interests, and helped to develop its secret apparatus or underground network. He also assisted in the recruitment of espionage sources and agents for the Soviet NKVD. Browder's own younger sister Marguerite was an NKVD operative in Europe until removed from those duties at Browder's request. It was at this point that the CPUSA's foreign policy platform came under the complete control of Stalin, who enforced his directives through his secret police and foreign intelligence service, the NKVD. The NKVD controlled the secret apparatus of the CPUSA, including responsibility for various political murders, kidnappings, and assassinations. The Popular Front 1935-1939. The ideological rigidity of the third period began to crack, however, with two events: the election of Franklin D. Roosevelt as President of the United States in 1932 and Adolf Hitler's rise to power in Germany in 1933. Roosevelt's election and the passage of the National Industrial Recovery Act in 1933 sparked a tremendous upsurge in union organizing in 1933 and 1934, while the party line still favored creation of autonomous revolutionary unions. Party activists chose to fold up those organizations and follow the mass of workers into the AFL unions they had been attacking. The 7th Congress of the Comintern made the change in line official in 1935, when it declared the need for a popular front of all groups opposed to fascism. The CPUSA abandoned its opposition to the New Deal, provided many of the organizers for the Congress of Industrial Organizations, and began supporting African American civil rights. The party also sought unity with forces to its right. Earl Russell Browder offered to run as Norman Thomas's running mate on a joint Socialist Party-Communist Party ticket in the 1936 presidential election, but Thomas rejected this overture. The gesture did not mean that much in practical terms, since the CPUSA was, by 1936, effectively supporting Roosevelt in much of his trade union work while continuing to run its own candidates for office. The CPUSA pursued a policy of representing the Democratic Party as the lesser evil in elections. Party members also rallied to the defense of the Spanish Republic during this period after a nationalist military uprising moved to overthrow it, resulting in the Spanish Civil War 1936-1939. The CPUSA, along with leftists throughout the world, raised funds for medical relief, while many of its members made their way to Spain with the aid of the party to join the Lincoln Brigade, one of the international brigades. Among its other achievements, the Lincoln Brigade included blacks and whites integrated on an equal basis intellectually. The Popular Front period saw the development of a strong communist influence in intellectual and artistic life. This was often through various organizations influenced or controlled by the party, or, as their critics described them, fronts. The CPUSA under Browder supported Stalin's show trials in the Soviet Union, called the Moscow Trials therein. Between August 1936 and mid-1938, the Soviet government indicted, tried, and shot virtually all of the remaining old Bolsheviks. Beyond the show trials lay a broader purge, the Great Purge, that killed millions. Browder uncritically supported Stalin, likening Trotskyism to cholera germs and calling the purge a signal service to the cause of progressive humanity. He compared the show trial defendants to domestic traitors Benedict Arnold, Aaron Burr, disloyal War of 1812 Federalists, and Confederate secessionists, while likening persons who smeared Stalin's name to those who had slandered Abraham Lincoln and Franklin Roosevelt opposition to foreign involvement 1939-1941. The Washington Commonwealth Federation newspaper after the signing of the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact original scan the CPUSA was adamantly opposed to fascism during the Popular Front period, although membership in the CPUSA rose to about 75,000 by 1938. Many members left the party after the Soviet Union signed the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact with Nazi Germany on August 23, 1939, citation needed, while General Secretary Browder at first attacked Germany for its September 1, 1939 invasion of Western Poland. On September 11, the CPUSA received a blunt directive from Moscow denouncing the Polish government between September 14-16. CPUSA leaders bickered about the direction to take. On September 17, the Soviet Union invaded Eastern Poland and occupied the Polish territory assigned to it by the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, followed by coordination with German forces in Poland. The British, French, and German Communist parties, all originally war supporters, abandoned their anti-fascist crusades, demanded peace, and denounced Allied governments. The CPUSA turned the focus of its public activities from anti-fascism to advocating peace, not only opposing military preparations but also condemning those opposed to Hitler. The CPUSA attacked British Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain and French leader Édouard Daladier, but did not at first attack President Roosevelt, reasoning that this could devastate American communism, blaming instead Roosevelt's advisers in October and November. After the Soviets invaded Finland and forced mutual assistance pacts from Estonia, Latvia and Lithuania, the CPUSA considered Russian security sufficient justification to support the action's secret shortwave radio broadcasts in October from Comintern. Leader Georgi Dimitrov ordered Stalinist Browder to change the CPUSA's support for Roosevelt on October 23. The CPUSA began attacking Roosevelt. The CPUSA dropped its boycott of Nazi goods, spread the slogans "The Yanks are not coming" and "Hands off," set up a "perpetual peace vigil" across the street from the White House, and announced that Roosevelt was the head of the War Party of the American bourgeoisie. By April 1940, the CPUSA Daily Workers' Line seemed not so much anti-war as simply pro-German. A pamphlet stated the Jews had just as much to fear from Britain and France as they did Germany. In August 1940, after NKVD agent Ramon Mercader killed Leon Trotsky with an ice axe, Browder perpetuated Moscow's fiction that the killer, who had been dating one of Trotsky's secretaries, was a disillusioned follower of World War II, and after 1941-1947 in allegiance to the Soviet Union. The party changed this policy again after Adolf Hitler broke the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact by attacking the Soviet Union on June 22, 1941. Communist Party USA bookstore in September 1942, with the pro-war slogan "A Second Front Now" throughout the rest of World War II, the CPUSA continued a policy of militant, if sometimes bureaucratic, trade unionism while opposing strike actions at all costs. The leadership of the CPUSA was among the most vocal pro-war voices in the United States, advocating unity against fascism, supporting the prosecution of leaders of the Socialist Workers' Party under the newly enacted Smith Act, and opposing a Philip Randolph's efforts to organize a march on Washington to dramatize black workers' demands for equal treatment on the job. Prominent CPUSA members and supporters, such as Dalton Trumbo and Pete Seeger, recalled anti-war material they had previously released. Earl Browder expected the wartime coalition between the Soviet Union and the West to bring about a prolonged period of social harmony after the war in order better to integrate the communist movement into American life. The party was officially dissolved in 1944 and replaced by a Communist Political Association. That harmony proved elusive, however, and the international communist movement swung to the left after the war ended. Browder found himself isolated when a critical letter from the leader of the French Communist Party received wide circulation as a result of this. In 1945 he was retired and replaced by William Z. Foster, who would remain the senior leader of the party until his own retirement in 1958 in line with other communist parties worldwide. The CPUSA also swung to the left and, as a result, experienced a brief period in which a number of internal critics argued for a more leftist stance than the leadership was willing to countenance. The result was the expulsion of a handful of premature anti-revisionists. Second Red Scare 1947-1958. Main article, Smith Act trials of Communist Party leaders. More important for the party was the renewal of state persecution of the CPUSA. The Truman administration's loyalty oath program, introduced in 1947, drove some leftists out of federal employment and, more importantly, raised awareness of communists as subversives, to be exposed and expelled from public and private employment. The House Committee on Un-American Activities, whose hearings were perceived by supporters as forums where current and former communists and those sympathetic to communism were compelled under the duress of the ruin of their careers to confess and name other communists, made even brief affiliation with the CPUSA or any related groups grounds for public exposure and attack. Rising popular support for resisting communism inspired local governments to adopt loyalty oaths and investigative commissions of their own private parties, such as the motion picture industry and self-appointed watchdog groups, extended the policy still further. This included the still controversial blacklist of actors, writers and directors in Hollywood who had been communists or who had fallen in with communist-controlled or influenced organizations in the pre-war and wartime years. The union movement purged party members as well. The CIO formally expelled a number of left-led unions in 1949 after internal disputes triggered by the party's support for Henry Wallace's candidacy for president and its opposition to the Marshall Plan, while other labor leaders sympathetic to the CPUSA either were driven out of their unions or dropped their alliances with the party. In 1949's Foley Square trial, the FBI prosecuted 11 members of the CPUSA's leadership, including Gus Hall and Eugene Dennis. The prosecution argued that the party endorsed a violent overthrow of the government, but the defendants countered that they advocated for a peaceful transition to socialism, and that the First Amendment's guarantee of free speech and association protected their membership in a political party. The trial, held in Manhattan's Foley Square courthouse, was widely publicized by the media, and was featured on the cover of Time magazine twice. Large numbers of protesters supporting the communist defendants were sent to protest outside the courthouse daily. The defense attorneys used a labor defense strategy, which attacked the process of the trial as a capitalist venture that would not provide a fair outcome to proletarian defendants. The tactic, which effectively stated the whole apparatus of the U.S. government was illegitimate, was not well received by the public. During the trial, the defense routinely antagonized the judge and prosecution, and five of the defendants were sent to jail for contempt of court for disrupting the trial. By the end of the trial, public opinion was overwhelmingly against the defendants, and after a 10-month trial, the jury found all 11 defendants guilty, and they were sentenced to terms of 5 years in federal prison. When the trial concluded, the judge sent all five defense attorneys to jail for contempt of court. Two of the attorneys were subsequently disbarred by government prosecutors. Encouraged by their success, arrested and convicted over 100 additional party officers in the early 1950s. The widespread fear of communism became even more acute after the Soviets' detonation of an atomic bomb in 1949 and discovery of Soviet espionage. Ambitious politicians, including Richard Nixon and Joseph McCarthy, made names for themselves by exposing or threatening to expose communists within the Truman administration or later, in McCarthy's case, within the United States Army. Liberal groups, such as the Americans for Democratic Action, not only distanced themselves from communists and communist causes, but defined themselves as anti-communist. Congress outlawed the CPUSA in the Communist Control Act of 1954. However, the act was largely ineffectual thanks in part to its ambiguous language. In the 1961 case, Communist Party v. Catherwood, the United States Supreme Court ruled that the act did not bar the party from participating in New York's unemployment insurance system. No administration has tried to enforce it since. By the mid-1950s, membership of Communist Party USA had slipped from its 1944 peak of around 80,000 to an active base of approximately 5,000. Some 1,500 of these members were FBI informants. To the extent that the Communist Party did survive, it was crippled by the penetration activities of these informants, who kept close surveillance on the few remaining legitimate members of the party. On behalf of FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover, and the CPUSA dried up as a base for Soviet espionage. "If it were not for me," Hoover told a State Department official in 1963, "there would not be a Communist Party of the United States because I've financed the Communist Party. In order to know what they are doing," William Sullivan, chief of intelligence operations for the FBI in the 1950s, has also described Hoover's continued zeal in pursuing action against the CPUSA as insincere. sincere, as he was fully aware of the party's moribund condition. Senator McCarthy had also kept up his attacks on the CPUSA during the 1950s despite also being aware of its impotency against the backdrop of these many setbacks. However, William Z. Foster, who was once again in a leadership role after the ouster of Earl Browder, and who, due to his poor health, had not been brought to trial in 1948 along with a number of other members of the party's leadership, wrote his History of the Communist Party of the United States. The party history is the record of the American class struggle, of which it is a vital part. It is the story, in general, of the growth of the working class, the abolition of slavery and emancipation of the Negro people, the building of the trade union and farmer movements, the numberless strikes and political struggles of the toiling masses, and the growing political alliance of workers, Negroes, farmers, and intellectuals, says Foster in the first chapter, illuminating a very different perspective of the party, from within. Party in Crisis 1956-1989. See also, New Communist Movement and Progressive Labor Party. United States. The 1956 Soviet invasion of Hungary and the secret speech of Nikita Khrushchev to the Communist Party of the Soviet Union criticizing Stalin had a cataclysmic effect on the previously Stalinist majority membership. CPUSA membership plummeted and the leadership briefly faced a challenge from a loose grouping led by Daily Worker editor John Gates, which wished to democratize the party. Perhaps the greatest single blow dealt to the party in this period was the loss of the Daily Worker, published since 1924, which was suspended in 1958 due to falling circulation. Most of the critics would depart from the party demoralized, but others would remain active in progressive causes and would often end up working harmoniously with party members. This diaspora rapidly came to provide the audience for publications like the National Guardian and Monthly Review, which were to be important in the development of the new left in the 1960s. The post-1956 upheavals in the CPUSA also saw the advent of a new leadership around former steel worker Gus Hall. Hall's views were very much those of his mentor Foster, but the younger man was to be more rigorous in ensuring the party was completely orthodox than the older man in his last years. Therefore, while remaining critics who wished to liberalize the party were expelled, so too were anti-revisionist critics who took an anti-Khrushchev stance. Many of these critics were elements on both U.S. coasts who would come together to form the Progressive Labor Movement in 1961. Progressive Labor would come to play a role in many of the numerous Maoist organizations of the mid-1960s and early 1970s. Jack Shulman, Foster's secretary, also played a role in these organizations. He was not expelled from the CPUSA, but resigned in the 1970s. The CPUSA managed to grow in membership to about 25,000 members, despite the exodus of numerous anti-revisionist and Maoist groups from its ranks from Glasnost to the 21st century 1989 present headquarters, Manhattan. In a 2002 article in People's Weekly World, CPUSA correspondents Marilyn Bechtel and Debbie Bell said of their trip to the People's Republic of China, "E came away with a new respect for the thoughtfulness, thoroughness, energy and optimism with which the Communist Party of China and the Chinese people are going about the complex, long-term process of building socialism in a vast developing country, which is of necessity part of an increasingly globalized economy." An overview of the Communist Party's current ideology can be found in the definitive report, Reflections on Socialism, by Sam Webb, the party's national chair. The article explains the party's support for a democratic, anti-racist, anti-sexist, immediate left-wing change for the United States. The report also covers the fall of the socialist bloc, claiming that democracy was not sufficiently developed in these countries. The report states, on the one hand, socialism transformed and modernized backward societies, secured important economic and social rights, assisted countries breaking free of colonialism, contributed decisively to the victory over Nazism, constituted by its mere presence a pressure on the ruling classes in the capitalist world to make concessions to their working classes and democratic movements, and acted as a counterweight to the aggressive ambitions of U.S. imperialism for nearly 50 years. The report stresses its dedication to revolutionary struggle, but states that Americans should look for peaceful revolutionary change. Webb says that capitalism cannot solve problems such as economic stagnation, racism, gender discrimination, or poverty. The report explains that there will be many transitory stages from capitalism, to socialism, and finally to communism. On the issue of markets in a socialist society, Webb states, "Admittedly, market mechanisms in a socialist society can generate inequality, disproportions distortions and imbalances, destructive competition, downward pressure on wages, and monopoly cornering of commodity markets, even the danger of capitalist restoration, but this is not sufficient reason for concluding that markets have no place in a socialist economy. The CPUSA recognizes the right of independence-seeking groups, many of whom have been led by communist and communist-oriented partisans, to defend themselves from imperialism, but rejects the use of violence in any United States uprising. The CPUSA argues that most violence throughout modern history is the result of capitalist ruling class violently trying to stop social change, notably the establishment of communist rule. While some governments run by people calling themselves communists have been responsible for horrible acts of violence and repression, notably the Pol Pot regime in Cambodia, much if not most of the violence often blamed on revolutionary governments and parties is actually the responsibility of the conservative, reactionary, capitalist governments and parties. Many revolutions have been relatively peaceful, including the Russian Revolution of 1917 and the Vietnamese Revolution of 1945. The bloodshed comes when those formerly in power initiate a civil war, or foreign armies invade, trying to re-establish capitalist, feudal, or colonial power. While we think that an objective, detailed analysis of most situations over the last century would conclude that capitalist and reactionary governments and parties are responsible for most of the violence, it is true that communists have engaged in armed struggle, are not pacifists, and that some who called themselves communists have engaged in repressive tactics in order to make room for the rental of four floors in the CPUSA National Building. The CPUSA had to move its extensive archives. The archives of the Communist Party USA were donated in March 2007 to the Tamamat Library at New York University. The massive donation, in 12,000 cartons, included history from the founding of the party, 20,000 books and pamphlets, and 1,000,000 photographs from the archives of the Daily Worker. The Tamamat Library also holds a copy of the microfilmed archive of Communist Party documents from Soviet archives held by the Library of Congress and from other materials which documents radical and left history. As of 2014, the platform of the party sets forth the following principles for its operations: a party of the working class, part of the class but its most advanced segment, a party of socialism based on Marxism-Leninism, engaged in proletarian internationalism organized on the principle of democratic centralism ideology. The CPUSA constitution program. According to its 2001 constitution, the party operates on the principle of democratic centralism, its highest authority being the Quadrennial National Convention. Article 6, Section 3 of the 2001 constitution lays out certain positions as non-negotiable: struggle for the unity of the working class, against all forms of national oppression, national chauvinism, discrimination and segregation, against all racist ideologies and practices, against all manifestations of male supremacy and discrimination against women, against homophobia and all manifestations of discrimination against gays, lesbians, bisexuals and transgender people. Among the points in the party's immediate program are a $15 per hour minimum wage for all workers, national universal health care, an opposition to privatization of social security, economic measures such as increased taxes on the rich and corporations, strong regulation of the financial industry, regulation and public ownership of utilities, and increased federal aid to cities and states, opposition to the Iraq War and other military interventions, opposition to free trade treaties such as the North American Free Trade Agreement NAFTA, nuclear disarmament and a reduced military budget, various civil rights provisions, campaign finance reform including public financing of campaigns, and election law reform, including instant runoff voting, Bill of Rights socialism. The Communist Party USA emphasizes a vision of socialism as an extension of American democracy, seeking to build socialism in the United States based on the revolutionary traditions and struggles of American history. The CPUSA promotes a conception of Bill of Rights socialism that will guarantee all the freedoms we have won over centuries of struggle, and also extend the Bill of Rights to include freedom from unemployment as well as freedom from poverty, from illiteracy, and from discrimination and oppression, reiterating the idea of property rights in socialist society as it is outlined in Marx and Engels's Communist Manifesto. The Communist Party emphasizes that many myths have been propagated about socialism. Contrary to right-wing claims, socialism would not take away the personal private property of workers, but the private ownership of major industries, financial institutions, and other large corporations, and the excessive luxuries of the super-rich rather than making all wages entirely equal, the Communist Party USA holds that building socialism would entail eliminating private wealth from stock speculation, from private ownership of large corporations, from the export of capital and jobs, and from the exploitation of large numbers of workers. Living standards among the primary concerns of the Communist Party are the problems of unemployment, underemployment and job insecurity, which communism understands as the natural result of the profit-driven incentives of the capitalist economy. Millions of workers are unemployed, underemployed, or insecure in their jobs. Even during economic upswings and periods of recovery from recessions, most workers experience long years of stagnant and declining real wages, while health and education costs soar. Many workers are forced to work second and third jobs to make ends meet. Most workers now average four different occupations during their lifetime. Many involuntarily moved from job to job and career to career often. Retirement age workers are forced to continue working just to provide health care for themselves and their families. Millions of people continuously live below the poverty level. Many suffer homelessness and hunger. Public and private programs to alleviate poverty and hunger do not reach everyone, and are inadequate even for those they do reach. With capitalist globalization, jobs move from place to place as capitalists export factories and even entire industries to other countries in a relentless search for the lowest wages. The Communist Party believes that class struggle starts with the fight for wages, hours, benefits, working conditions, job security, and jobs, but it also includes an endless variety of other forms for fighting specific battles: resisting speed-up, picketing, contract negotiations, strikes, demonstrations, lobbying for pro-labor legislation, elections, and even general strikes. The Communist Party's national programs understands that workers who struggle against the capitalist class or any part of it on any issue with the aim of improving or defending their lives are part of the class struggle. Imperialism and war. The Communists maintain that developments within the foreign policy of the United States is reflected in the rise of neoconservatives and other groups associated with